coming to you from the city where the prices of pizza and subway rides have stayed proportionate for over 50 years, it's Ventriloquism Weekly. Mondays are so much fun. For me, at least. I know that a lot of you are like, oh, Monday, where's my coffee? Matt Bailey here, and another Monday means another ventriloquist. Mark Merchant joins us today. Merchant has performed for many major cruise lines over the years. When not at sea, he performs for corporate clients and at comedy clubs in his home state of Georgia. This has made him one of the most sought-after clean adult entertainers working today. Here now to tell us how he escaped the possibility of being pigeonholed as a children's entertainer, our interview with Mark Merchant. Mark Merchant, welcome to Ventriloquism Weekly. How are you today, sir?
I'm happy. It's a pleasure to be on this podcast, this broadcast, this whatever cast this is, a cast of thousands and one ventriloquist to make the cast work. So thank you for inviting me, Matt.
Well, thank you for accepting the invitation. It's a pleasure to have you. I want to begin at the beginning. How did you get started in ventriloquism?
I'm sure you've heard this story many times in the interviews that you've done. I started in ventriloquism because as a kid, I saw a performer come to a Cub Scout Blue and Gold Banquet.
Oh, cool.
An Atlanta performer who did magic and ventriloquism. And because he did both, I thought that the two art forms always went together. So I got a magic kit for Christmas when I was 8 years old. And when I was 10 years old, I got a Danny O'Day ventriloquist dummy, as we sometimes call him, figure, just one with the string on the back of the neck.
Very cool.
And a record by Jimmy Nelson, Instant Ventriloquism. And I came from the middle of the middle class. My parents were kind enough to afford me the opportunity for guitar lessons and piano lessons, but those things, there was a problem. I did not want to practice.
Right.
You don't practice unless you're a child prodigy, and I was a child prodigy, but I peaked very early. But I enjoyed practicing ventriloquism. I used to literally sit in front of the mirror for hours, not only because I'm a narcissist, but because I wanted to make sure my lip control was perfect. So the exercises that were on the Jimmy Nelson record, The Boy Bought a Basketball and Many Men Make Money, I used to sit and practice those and practice the lines. And when I was in the fifth grade, I did a show for my fifth grade class. Mr. Caldwell was a teacher. God bless him. Odell Caldwell. He said, hey, Merchant, we'll put you in. And I remember he got out his planning book and said, well, we'll let you do a show. And I did the show. And when I had my puppet, who I just called Danny at the time, Danny O'Day,
right,
I said, one of the lines that was right in the script, I said, how do you like this audience? And he pointed over to the teacher. He said, I like that bald-headed man over there. The teacher was bald. And I said, Danny, you shouldn't call him bald. I'm sorry, sir, you're not bald. You're just too tall for your hair. It's a great joke. And we're going back to 1964, 1965 when I did that performance.
Mm-hmm.
And I still do that joke today. I won't do it about a member of the audience. I have a bald eagle puppet, and the bald eagle refers to himself. I learned a long time ago that you can make fun of a lot of things, but I never, ever make fun of baldness because I know, I imagine, I'm not bald, thank you God, I imagine that baldness is one of those things that probably bothers some people. And when I've been to some shows and I've seen people do jokes about bald-headed guys, I've looked at the look on their faces and thought, I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to be that guy who points that out because you can't help being bald. So have I answered your question in a long enough?
Oh, I love the stories, and I love when things crop in your head like that, because that informs the next question, which was just going to be, so then how do you pick on the audience? What gets the laugh but doesn't make fun of them?
Say the first part of the question again. I lost a little in translation.
Oh, absolutely. I said, what's appropriate when picking on the audience? How do you get that laugh but not make fun of them?
It's a fine line. It is literally like walking a tightrope. Sometimes you err on the side of, okay, I'm going to get the laugh, and later you find out that you've really touched a nerve with somebody.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think there's a hard and fast rule. I mean, I was entertaining at a comedy club 2 weeks ago here in Atlanta, the Punchline. It was a benefit for ALS, which I figured doing a free show was better than dumping a bucket of ice water on my head. And there was a moment when a lady got up right in the front, and my character said, "Don't leave." And she said, "I want to get some more wine." Well, right then, I didn't wrestle with myself. Just the puppet came back with the line, "I see. So not all alcoholics are anonymous." Now, that got a great laugh. Maybe it pointed out that she couldn't sit through a show without getting some more wine. But everyone around laughed. If it hurt her feelings, it wasn't personal. It was just for the laugh. That's what sometimes people don't get, especially in the type of humor that I do and some other ventriloquists that I know do. It's always about the laugh. Can we get a laugh? Can the show be funny? Anything that I say or that comes out of my puppet's mouth on stage, it's never personal, unless it's some rude heckler, and then maybe it has been personal, but then I don't really care about what the person feels if they're drunk and interrupting the show. But this person wasn't drunk and interrupting the show. They just had to get up right in the front row as I'm on stage and say, "I've got to go get some more wine."
And I mean, in retrospective, from this perspective, if I may, I don't know if this is too far off of what you're thinking about, but that is kind of a little bit rude on the part of a person if you're sitting that close to the stage. I could understand they were further back and they could sneak out easily, but it's live entertainment, and I think sometimes we forget that.
It is, and it's not like this comedy club did not have a wait staff,
right,
and waitresses who were coming up to the tables, but she didn't want to wait for the waitress to come up and say, "Would anybody like anything else?" She made her way from the front row to the bar to get some more wine.
Yeah. So you bring up this wonderful, talk about the atmosphere you come to perform, and we were talking when we were establishing that we were going to do the interview that you do almost any type of venue except kid shows, and you knew that you really don't want to do kid shows, and I do this show because it's also a journey for me and finding out who I am as an entertainer, and I've always felt like that, and I think, you know, kid shows are great for those that can do them, but there's a need for clean adult comedy. So how did you come to knowing that that was the type of venue you wanted to perform in?
Through trial and error. When I began doing this and getting paid for it when I was in high school, of course I did a lot of shows for birthday parties. It was,
right.
Look back on it now and I think I was like 14 years old. My mom and dad would drive me to a show. God bless Sherwood and Peggy Merchant for driving me to shows. I didn't have a driver's license at 14. And I was doing a show at a birthday party for kids who were maybe 6 or 7. I mean, they were like half my age. And just because I was a teenager and had a skill of entertaining, I could make them. They were my peers at the time.
Right.
But even then, Matt, when I would get booked at a Kiwanis club for adults or a Lions club or a church group that was adults, and I was this 14, 15-year-old kid who did magic and ventriloquism, even then I knew right then that inherently I enjoyed entertaining adults more. Not because I was doing any type of humor that I shouldn't have been doing as a young teenager, but just the appreciation of the art. And you didn't have those snotty-nosed kids yelling, "I know where it is, and you're talking, your lips are moving." You know, I mean, I think children's performers should be issued probably a stun gun. I'm sure there are people that are going to call Child Protective Services, and I have done I have done some kid shows recently because of the work situation, and some of them, like Cub Scout Banquets, have been great because it's a very disciplined group. But then when I get to set up my equipment, my sound system, get my characters ready at a kid show, and kids just start coming up to the stage and just bugging you, I have a hard time just saying, please, you need to go sit down with your mom and dad. You never have to do that in a show with adults.
No.
I did a show in April, I'm not making this up, at a nudist resort in Virginia.
My
word. The Whitetail Resort. And it was a great audience. I was not nude, nor were my puppets. But as I was setting up my stuff, nobody came up and walked up on the stage and like, how you doing? Where's your puppets? Like, you know, they recognize this is a professional doing his gig, getting ready to do his show. And I mean, after the show, I'm glad to talk with people. After the show, I'm even glad to talk with the kids.
Right.
But I knew early on, Matt, that entertaining adults is just more fun. I've entertained in family shows.
Mm-hmm.
And family shows, if the kids are all, say, 6 and above, and they've got a modicum of self-control, it's okay. But a complete kid show, like I did a show at a country club in Georgia, Monroe, Georgia. It was a short money, and the lesson learned here is anytime you do somebody a favor, you know that you're going to get hurt in the process, not physically, but I did a show for short money to help a guy out, and I got to the Monroe Country Club to entertain for a Halloween party, and they stressed, it has to be clean, has to be clean, has to be family friendly. I said, no problem. I get there, and they're little kids, and I'm talking like one-year-olds, crawling around on the floor of the clubhouse, of the showroom. I'm up on a riser that's maybe 9 inches high. I've got my stuff set. Kids are running up on stage, pulling at my pants legs, and the adults are all sitting there because they're all half drunk, and
yeah.
They're all sitting there with their phones and they're texting. But the best moment that came out of that show, Matt, was when I pulled out my black character, Alonzo Jackson, and when I pulled him out, and we do a song that I wrote called White Boy from Atlanta. You got a white boy from Atlanta. You got a black man on your arm, some get up tight. You know that's right. I'm going to do the whole song anyway. When I pulled that puppet out and the music started, a little girl about 3 in some kind of ballerina outfit in Monroe is probably one of the most lily white areas of Georgia. And when I pulled that black puppet out, that little girl screamed like she had seen Satan himself. And of course, I just got through the song. And then the puppet said, I told you there'd be tears if you bring a black man to the Monroe Country Club. And needless to say, I'm not going to get invited back to the Monroe Country Club. But, you know, I don't care because they treated me very unprofessionally. And the fact that adults are... But another saving grace was a guest at the country club, an adult, came up to me after the show. And he said, you really had a great show. And I said, thank you. Well, I'm thinking, which show did you see?
Yeah.
He said, I am embarrassed for you because, he said, no one controlled these kids. They just let them run wild. He said, and your talent is far above that grade. You shouldn't have to put up with this. And I said, thank you very much. But the next day I got an evil email from the country club saying that my show was not family friendly. I said the word rehab in my show. I'm like thinking, really? Is that a bad word? I have a bald eagle that I found at the Raptor Rehabilitation Center, which is not a rehabilitation center where Charlie Sheen goes to. It's a place where eagles, owls, and falcons go to be rehabilitated if they've been injured so they can be released back into the wild.
Right.
And they took issue with the word rehab and the fact that I also, this was 2012, they took issue also that I commented on the upcoming presidential election between Obama and, wow, this is only 2014. Whom did Obama run against?
Romney.
Romney, thank you. That yes. guy. That guy, yes.
And yeah.
Anyway, I've gone on about the Monroe Country Club. I've just, my experiences with entertaining for kids has never been where I've thought. With the exception, I might add, I'm married 26 years to a retired school teacher. She just retired this year. God bless her.
God bless.
Taught 38 years in the public government school system. And in 1986, through a connection with my good friend, magician David Ginn, he was booking me at school assembly shows, cultural art shows. It was just, I was trying to get different streams of income besides cruise ships and casinos, and so I was doing shows at schools. Obviously, different material, had to have a somewhat of a lesson plan and send out to the people, and I worked it. And the best thing about it was I met a good-looking teacher, which I got on stage for the audience participation bit where I turned her into the puppet, and I ended up dating her and marrying her. So,
oh, that is a wonderful, that's an awesome story, actually. That's audience.
Absolutely true. Camp Creek Elementary School, May 8, 1986, I met Cindy Osborne, and she called me up that night and said, you mentioned you wanted to take me to dinner. Why don't you just take me on one of those cruises on which you work? Which I thought, wow, coming from a good-looking Southern Baptist girl, this could work.
So, yeah.
So we started dating, and but my days of school shows were numbered even at that point. I continued to do some of them, and middle schools, junior highs sometimes were, and I'm talking in the late 80s, were they were particularly contentious sometimes because you'd get out there and you'd try to keep it where, okay, this is going to be fun for these junior high, but obviously you couldn't go with any kind of adult subjects or they'd run you out of there. But a lot of the kids, and I'm sure it's the same thing now, they're too cool for school and they don't want to, here comes a guy with a puppet, like, well, how, maybe the fact that Jeff Dunham is a superstar now and making tons of money, and God bless him, he certainly deserves it. Maybe ventriloquism is, but I do notice every time I do a ventriloquist show, no matter where it is, people start talking about Jeff. And,
oh, yeah.
They come up in silence. They give you on a stick. They give you all the key phrases, and I'm like, I'm sitting right here. I'm the guy here now.
Yeah.
Talk about me. I'm the guy you hired. If you had hired Jeff Dunham, I don't think you could afford him here at this country club.
Yeah. So you talk about all these different wonderful adult venues that you work in, and one of them being cruise ships. Can you talk about, there's this rumor, this sort of belief among entertainers that when you do cruise ships, that just vacuum packs all your business on land and just completely, if you'll forgive the pun, dries it up on land. And you seem to have success and found other venues other than cruise ships and are able to keep those different streams of income coming other than cruise ships. What is the secret to that, and is there any truth at all to the risk of losing land business when you're on a cruise ship?
There is truth to risk of losing land business when one is on cruise ships. If one takes cruise ship gigs that go on for months at a time. Now, that used to happen with me. I have been entertaining professionally, mainly on cruise ships, corporate dates, for 36 years. And when I first started, I was 23 years old. And I would sometimes go on a cruise ship and park myself on there for 4 months at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And I, let me tell you, Matt, I was glad to get the income, glad to get the stage time, and didn't worry about land gigs. But because I'm good at networking, or I try to be good at networking, and I would meet guests on the ship, and they would say, do you do private shows? Do you do shows for companies? And I'm the manager of the Acme Distributing Company, and Oklahoma City, would you like to come and entertain for our group? And I'm like, yes, I would. And usually it was far enough in advance that I would book that in advance, and I would just block that off on my calendar. And once I got out of the working on ships for 3 and 4 months at a time, these days, about the longest gig I get on a ship is about 2 weeks. I'll be on for 2 weeks, and then sometimes I'll be home in Atlanta for a week. And during that time in Atlanta, I try to make sure that I've got a gig, even if it's a gig at a comedy club at the Punchline where I'm not getting paid, but I'm getting stage time, and all the money is going to benefit something good like the ALS Foundation.
Right.
I want to keep working. So the main thing to making it work on land and at sea is you have to be out there self-promoting yourself at all times, not to a degree that you're carrying a puppet around with you on the cruise ship. That is a sure ticket to getting in trouble. But an entertainment director for a line named Greg Von Seeger, who was the entertainment director for Cunard and Seabourn and Royal Viking, he told me, he said, Marcus, after the show, you work your way around quickly to the back of the theater as guests are coming out and say, thanks for coming, and shake their hand. Thanks for coming. First of all, if you've done any material that people think, boy, that was a little risky or that was a little racy, if they get to meet me and learn that I at least I think I am, I'm a genuinely nice person. I mean, I'm a human being, so I'm as flawed as the other guy, but I like people, and thanks mm-hmm. for coming to the show. And that makes a big difference, and I am so thankful to Greg for telling me that, because by doing that, Matt, I've had guests come up to me and say, I enjoyed your show, and I'm shaking their hand. I say, thank you. And they go, I'm an event planner. Do you do private events? And I go, yes, I do. There's a second key. Always have your business cards in your lapel pocket or someplace where you can say, here you go, and hand them a card. And that's all you need to do. And if you can get a 1% or 2% return on the card you hand out, I've done corporate events in Los Angeles that are multi-$1,000 events as a result of standing there shaking hands.
Yeah.
And then when you get the contract for the corporate event, you let them know that you'll customize the material. I had a show in February for a cinema group, NCM, the largest owner of movie theaters in the United States. And they also, if you go to a movie and all that pre-show stuff where it's basically advertising, this company is the one that produces all of that production stuff that they show before the movie. And the man saw me on a crystal ship, Cliff is his name, and said, hey, I've got an event coming up in Las Vegas. I think you'd be great. And can you customize it and do some jokes about the people there? And you bet. Mm-hmm. That's something that I shine in, being able to make it relevant to the group. So in order to be successful on land and on cruise ships, you've just got to be adaptable to both venues. I heard an old joke a long time ago. A guy said he'd worked on cruise ships so long that every time he got a date on land, they had to pour a bucket of water under his feet so he felt at home.
That's wonderful. And so it really is just sort of cross-promotion.
Exactly. That's a good term, cross-promotion.
And so, you know, what type of shows are you doing on the cruise ships? All the big family headliner shows or kind of the nightclub situations?
I do the headliner shows as a guest entertainer. That's what entertainers are called, that are guest entertainers. You're on the guest list, but you're an entertainer. You're working on the ship. And I generally do as I'm told or asked to on a ship. Sometimes I'll fly into a ship and it'll be leaving that night and they'll say, okay, there's a welcome aboard show. The cruise director is going to come on and do a few things and the singers and dancers are going to get the show kind of hopping. And then we just need like 10 minutes from you, from the comedy act, to get it going. And I love that. I love coming on the first night, and I try to storm it on that first night. I know some guest entertainers who say, well, that's just a welcome aboard show. I don't want to waste my good stuff. In my humble opinion, you need to go out with your best stuff in your first shot, because that's going to determine how many people are going to come to that next show, your next show where you're doing a full 45 minutes.
Right.
So a lot of times on cruise ships these days, you just do as you're asked. Like, we've talked about kids shows. I work a lot on Crystal Cruise Lines, which is a very high-end cruise line. And when I'm on there in the summertime, and if I'm on for a holiday cruise, Christmas, and there's kids on board, they don't have to ask me. I always volunteer, hey, would you like me to do a special show for the kids? Now, a show for the kids, they do it in a small room because they only have about 20, 25 kids. And as long as I've got a microphone, and I do some of the stuff that I used to do in school shows, but I will be honest with you, I always mix in a little bit of magic. I have a hard time, and maybe I'm not the only one, I have a hard time doing ventriloquism for kids for like a full 30 minutes because, okay, you've got a puppet, you've got characterizations, you've got jokes, you finish your bit with that character and then bring out another character. I think kids, okay, here's a guy with a puppet. When every one of them has a phone in their hand that they can dial up Venus, a guy with a puppet sometimes is not that enchanting. So you've got to do it based on personality and hopefully talent. And so I add some magic to that. So I will do a kid show on a ship, just one reason, to ensure my employment.
Yeah.
And another because it's a way to get some stage time. And if the kids like it, they might tell their parents, hey, I saw the ventriloquist today. And then the parents will come to the show and hopefully leave the kids at home. Not because I do anything dirty, just because if there are kids in a show, in, say, the main theater in a show, and you go anywhere, even breaching something sexual or political, it's going to potentially make people feel uncomfortable.
Right. So, yeah, just sort of compartmentalize and get to the different groups on the ship in such a wonderfully controlled environment.
Yes.
So that's wonderful. And something you mentioned a while back about getting stage time at a club, not necessarily for the money, but just for the stage time in between these 2-week-long stints. At what point does that happen? Because there's open mics and then there's bringers and there's different things. At what point in working with a club does it happen where you're getting stage time but you're not getting paid, but they're giving you the time you don't really need to do much of anything to just go up and have a few minutes?
Well, open mics certainly have their place, but at this point in my career, and this is not ego talk, and this is just experience.
Of course.
By doing an open mic at this point in my career, it's generally a no-win situation. The last time I did an open mic was at a comedy club in downtown Atlanta called the Laughing Skull Comedy Club. And they acted like getting a spot on the open mic there was, oh, this is great. So I went down there, and first of all, the sound was terrible. When I said I do some music in my act, there's a CD that you play, they were reticent to do that. And when I went on, and I was only allowed 6 minutes, I did my 6 minutes, I got good laughs, good applause. And then because there was no way out where one could, especially when you're carrying characters, puppets, so I sat and watched the rest of the show. And I will say the rest of the 2-hour show was complete amateur night in Dixie, literally in Dixie. It was in Atlanta, Georgia. And a lot of really bad comedians they needed some place to try out, but I didn't need to be with that group.
Right. But
the piece de resistance was at the end of the evening, I went up to the guy named Marshall who ran the club, and I said, well, I'm a polite guy. I said, thanks for letting me have the open night experience. That I hope you like what you saw, and I hope you'll use me some night, you know, for a paid gig. And he said, oh, I would never use a ventriloquist in this club. And I said, well, why did you even let me do the open mic night? And he said, well, I just thought you wanted some stage time. I said, Marshall, if I want stage time, I'll just go to a local AA group and make up stuff. I said, I'm a professional. This is what I do for a living. I said, I wasted an evening that I could have been home with my wife and my dog. I said, I don't think I gained anything here tonight except being probably the best act on the bill. And
right.
I say that with humbleness because I said, will you let me know? He said, no, I wouldn't use a ventriloquist unless you're a straight comic. He said, if you want to come back and try something without the puppets, we'll see how it goes. And I just said, see ya.
Yeah.
So open mic nights. So like when I did the comedy club 2 weeks ago, I'm on the mailing list of the Punchline, and I saw where it was having this ALS benefit. And I know the guy who books it, Chris DePetta, and I just wrote him an email, and I said, Chris, this sounds like a worthy cause. I would love to come in, and how long would I get? He said, hey, Mark, we'd love to have you. Can you do 15 minutes? I'm like, yeah. I mean, 15 minutes is a nice size set.
Absolutely.
I was the only ventriloquist out of comedians. I worked clean, and I got good laughs, and I exchanged the business cards with some people. Maybe I'll get some dates out of it. And Chris DePetta was very thankful. He said, I'll use you at the club again sometime, Mark. I'd use you at the club for pay, which is a good thing.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful. That is a wonderful experience that once you reach a certain level, and that's something that we can all learn from, is that once you reach a certain level of professionalism, there's certain things you shouldn't have to do anymore just by virtue of the fact that they could hurt you or at least not benefit you in any way.
Right.
Right. So, and this last question I want to ask, because this is always how I wrap it up, and I want to know what you want to see from ventriloquists coming up, future cruise ship workers, future comedy club and corporate workers. What would you like to see?
Well, what I would like to see from ventriloquists and comedians is more originality, less of stuff that we've all seen before. And I've fallen into that trap. Some gags are stock gags, and they're stock gags because they work. But I love it when somebody breaks out of the mold and does something totally that I haven't seen. At the Ventriloquist Convention a year ago, 2013, on the international show, there was a gentleman from Norway who had like a small puppet that he kept putting all these masks on.
Yes.
And changed the puppet. And I just thought that was so, I mean, yeah, of course it was storming it at the Ventriloquist Convention because we're all ventriloquists. We're all recognizing how unique that is. Part of me thought, well, would this work in the real world? I don't know. I would also like to see less emphasis on the whole political correct nonsense.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen any of my show, but I have an Asian puppet named Wingtip Shu.
Mm-hmm.
I have a black puppet named Alonzo Jackson. I have a bald eagle who has a comb over, who has a Hispanic accent. His name is Jose Diego, as in Jose the Eagle, but it's Jose Diego. And they're funny, and they're not making fun of those ethnic groups. They're just making fun of life. And in these politically correct days, once in a while, I get in trouble because I have that puppet, not because of any lines that I use, but I come out with that puppet and people are like, you're a white guy, you shouldn't have a black puppet, you're a white guy, you shouldn't have an Asian puppet. I don't get it. So I would like to see political correctness die the death that it needs to die.
Yeah.
In this country, and certainly on stage. One of the highlights for me at the Ventriloquist Convention this past July was Willie Tyler's performance and his afternoon question and answer.
Oh, that was wonderful to see.
People kept wanting to bring up the whole thing that he's black. And they had two people. I'm not going to mention his name because I think he's on the vent board. He talked about being in a racist family, and he was a white guy and all this kind of stuff. And I remember sitting next to my friend at the Ventriloquist Convention, and we both looked at each other and said, why is he bringing this crap up? This has nothing to do with anything. And then another guy stood up, a ventriloquist from Chicago stood up and said, you know, I'm a black guy, and Willie Tyler said, hey, I went out there with blinders on. He said, I was just trying to get laughs.
Right.
I didn't care about the color of the audience. And I led a standing ovation for him because, to me, that says it all. We're
mm-hmm.
just trying to get laughs. I'm not a social commentator. I'm not commenting on anybody. If I make a joke about Obama, it's because it's fodder for jokes, because he's done something that I think is funny. If I then turn around and do a joke about Sarah Palin, you can't get more polarizing than those two cats.
Right.
And it's not that I don't like Sarah Palin or that I don't necessarily like Obama. It's because this is the subject matter.
Mm-hmm.
So I would like to see political correctness be shunted to the sewer that it needs to crawl back into.
Oh, that is wonderful. Thank you so much, Mark Merchant. Thank you so much for a wonderful, very insightful interview today. Thank you so much for being here.
Well, thank you for inviting me, and I hope people will check out my website, markmerchant.com, and there's links to, and I'm on Facebook, and I've got a fan page, which has about 5 deeply disturbed fans, and I've got a YouTube channel, and I try to post current things that I'm doing.
Thank you again to Mark Merchant. Wonderful time talking with you. You know, The reasons he outlined are the reasons I love and respect kid show performers. Not everyone is suited to that market. I think it's good to hear the flip side sometimes because we don't get a lot of that. That the benefits of avoiding it altogether if you're not meant for performing for kids. I think sometimes it's good to discuss. I know a lot of you vents out there love to perform for kids, and a lot of you like to do the more clean adult venues like Mark. So I love that we got to present that side of it. So that was so much fun. Well, that's it for us this week. Next week, Magic and Entertainment legend Tom Mullica joins us in an interview that you do not want to miss. It's very different, very, very open, very honest, and just be prepared for next week because a lot of stuff coming. It's really cool. I appreciate the way he took the conversation. Not how I was expecting, but well, we'll talk more about that next week. I'm very excited about that. A reminder, you can find all you need to know by visiting ventriloquismweekly.com. You can find out everything you needed to know, everything you ever wanted to know, and some stuff you didn't about this show, VW. You can also email in. You get me directly if you email ventriloquismweekly@gmail.com. Find our group on Facebook by searching ventriloquismweekly-podcast for ventriloquists. Tweet us at talk42. Oh, and tweet about us using hashtag talk42. From New York, signing off for Ventriloquism Weekly, I'm Matt Bailey, reminding all you vents out there to keep talking for two.